Okay, good afternoon, everybody, or good morning, I guess, depending on where you are. This is Dean Woodbeck from In Common. Thank you for joining I Am Online today. And I will introduce our moderator, Tom Barton, who is the Senior Director of IT Architecture, Integration, and Security, and also the Chief Information Security Officer at the University of Chicago. Tom, take it away.
Thanks, Dean. Hi, folks, and welcome to IAM Online. This is the monthly webinar focused on identity and access management. It's brought to you by In Common, Internet 2, and the EDUCAUSE Higher Education Information Security Council, HISC. Like we always do, we'll take comments and questions in the chat in the Adobe Connect session, and I'll be monitoring that while Rich is talking, and so we'll just kind of do. So be they are rich. Doing to an extent, I think. those. So, but let me kind of just introduce you to the whole topic in my kind of brief eight-bullet way, I guess, in terms of what's up with two-factor and multi-factor. And I'm going to use those terms probably interchangeably. For most of us, I think two-factor is the form of multi-factor authentication that we are doing or thinking a lot about. And the first is that it's the best single mitigation against the negative impacts of phishing. It by itself doesn't deter phishing, but it reduces some of the deleterious effects that can occur when phishing, when accounts are compromised due to phishing. There's one of my colleagues at another at a peer institution who was ahead of us and many of us, I would say, in terms of how far they've deployed two-factor on their campus. At some point last fall, we're about 75% of the way through a plan to get everyone finally on two-factor, and they found. Approximately a 75% reduction in So that number might be a little bit quite encouraging. So phishing, two-factor is great antidote against phishing. Of course, passwords obtained any other way as well are often shared and otherwise easy to crack. The hackers out there have hundreds of millions of actual passwords they've gathered over the year. They've organized them into online services where if they get some passwords by whatever means, they can dump them in a hopper, pay a little bit of money or for free and get them cracked, unless they're quite long, basically, and complicated. So they're just not great protection anymore, so you need the second factor. So I'm sorry, but that's just the way it is from the likes of us security guys anyway. But there's some pretty good news. There are good options. Rich is going to talk about two of them today with reasonable cost or even very little to no cost for the licensing. There's pretty good user experience you can get, although, as Rich will point out, you have you can get to security. Terrible inconvenience in this case. integration. For protecting web apps with two-factor and remote access solutions and shell and console access. And there's a lot of, you've got a lot of company, a lot of folks are engaged, a little Googling for like two-factor or multi-factor site colon edu will show you scads of edus that have some kind of a scene going on two-factor right now. Also the detail, you know, in the federated world, if you're using Shibboleth or SAML Federation, there is just about fully blessed as a standard within the next 2 weeks or so, a way to signal, a service to signal that it wants two-factor or multi-factor from the identity provider. So that's great. That's one thing that can be done in a standard way that currently needs to be done kind of ad hoc every time it's done. The downside